So for everybody who's dialed in today, I want to introduce our new host of our Flash Talk series, Dennis Koester. Dennis recently joined us after a long career in biotech and pharma. He started his career at Novartis and was most recently a director at FibroGen. He has a fantastic lineup of speakers set up already this year. And Oliver is the first. So Dennis, I'll let you take it away from here.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dennis, for this introduction. Yeah, hello, everybody. It's my pleasure. I'm the Director of Industry Research and Relations here at Drug Hunter, and it's my pleasure to be the host of the series going forward. We're really happy you dialed in today, and I'm glad to have Oliver here today. Before we get started, I wanted to do some housekeeping items. So while while you can see and hear us, we cannot see and hear you. So to interact with us, please use the chat box. And if you could maybe drop in where you're dialing in from into the chat, that would be really, really cool and would help Oliver to warm up a little bit and relate to the audience. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the distinct Q&A box. Don't use the chat box. Please make sure to use the Q&A box, and we will collect questions during the seminar, and we'll then ask them when Oliver is finished. Before I introduce Oliver, I wanted to show you something on our Drug Hunter webpage, what we're offering on our Drug Hunter premium page. So one of the articles that we have and that Oliver actually wrote is about the topic of today, GLP-1 receptor agonists and how they evolve from diabetes treatment to weight loss treatments. So here in those types of articles, you'll be able to see types of diabetes type 2 classes, you'll see structures, you'll see how the targets are set up in the cell and what kind of targets these drugs interfere with, what the effect of GLP-1 on different organs is, what kind of structures, how the structures evolved of the GLP-1 receptor agonists. Additionally, there'll be like tables with what compounds are still available. So you get a lot of information from these types of articles on Drug Hunter Premium, even revenue tables of how the revenue of insulin or GLP-1 receptor agonist developed over time. And then for the medicinal chemists in the audience, we also have those small molecule case studies. And we recently actually did an update on this orforglipron article here from Chugai and Lilly, where we included a lot more cryo-EM structures. And you see really the depth of the article that would save you a lot of time during doing your research. So taking that all of this into account would probably take you multiple weeks. And here on Drug Hunter, you can read it in just a few minutes. We also have the case study of danuglipron here as well. And you can see similar depth. You see the structures, competitive landscape. So it's really, really cool. Pfizer used a very innovative screening to discover that. You can read more about this on Drug Hunter. Yes, so I wanted to introduce Oliver, our speaker, to you today. So Dr. Oliver Philps got his PhD at the University of Sussex with Professor Douglas Young, working on novel amino acids as glutamate receptor antagonists and nitric oxide inhibitors. He's an experienced medicinal chemist who has worked for a diverse range of biotech and pharma companies throughout his career, including Vertex Pharmaceuticals, GSK, AstraZeneca, and Eisai. And he has extensive experience in progressing compounds from hit to lead, through lead optimization and candidate selection in the fields of oncology, inflammation, and CNS. And in addition, Oliver has a passion for understanding the bigger picture of the pharmaceutical industry and a particular interest in competitive intelligence. Oliver, it's a pleasure to have you today. And before we get started with your talk, excuse me, I wanted to ask you a few questions to warm up to the audience. So what actually inspired you to get started in drug discovery?
Okay, well, thank you for the invite. There's been a few different times in my life that I've had to make key decisions. And what I found was I had a very good chemistry teacher at secondary school who instilled a passion for science and particularly chemistry. I then wanted to do chemistry at university, and luckily I had a family friend who worked for Cancer Research UK, and he mentioned or told me all the different types of chemistry courses and the different types of chemistry. And to me, medicinal chemistry seemed to be the thing I would like to do, use chemistry to make drugs of the future. And so I went to Sussex University, and I had the had a very good course, had someone from Wellcome Laboratories who came in and gave case studies. And it was really, really interesting. And then I got the chance to work at Wellcome Laboratories for a summer, and that kind of ignited my passion. And it was a natural progression after doing a PhD to move into the industry. So
awesome. Yeah, no, that's pretty awesome. So in the industry, while you've been working in the industry, what's your favorite drug and why?
Well, I actually have two favorite drugs. They are called checkpoint inhibitors. Mm-hmm. They work on the PD-1 or programmed cell death 1 receptor. They are Keytruda and Opdivo. Keytruda is Merck's cash cow, makes about 40% of their revenue per year. And BMS brought out Opdivo. These drugs are really important because they are actually successful as immuno-oncology drugs, and they work with, they're not like normal drugs. They actually work. Keytruda is approved for about 30 different indications of oncology, and Opdivo greater than 20 indications. So they're real game changers. It just so happened that Keytruda is the number one selling drug these days. It's $25 billion in revenue last year. So these drugs are amazing, really.
Yeah, no, they definitely are. And I think that's a really, really interesting topic. Is this the topic that you're most excited about today also, or is there any other area of drug discovery that you're most excited about today?
Having gone through the COVID pandemic, obviously messenger RNA technology was mm-hmm. used in the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine. And it'd be really interesting to see what other mRNA therapies come out of that, because now it's been proven and been approved for a wide scale disease or indication. So I think that'd be really interesting to watch that going forward.
No, that's definitely cool. Maybe, you know, different types of cancer vaccines can come from that. So that's super, super interesting. I wonder what kind of advice would you give yourself if you started your career, like with the knowledge that you gained today, what kind of advice would you give your younger self? That's the question we like to ask.
I always say, follow your passion. If you follow mm-hmm. your passion, it's not really a job. You enjoy yourself. If you find a hobby that you really like and turn it into a job, great. What I would say as a scientist, enjoy the good times, because you can have very bleak times. There's a lot of times where you have things not working. So enjoy the good times and make sure you enjoy the highs.
Yeah, no, that speaks to me really, because I'm like a very optimistic type of person. So I really do like to enjoy the good times. All right, Oliver, maybe one more question and then we'll get started on your presentation. What is your favorite thing about Drug Hunter?
Obviously, you offer a lot of different services. I like the way that when you come to the site and read an article, you learn about a whole subject within that article. You give good enough links to various sites or journals and papers. So it's sort of one-stop shop. Obviously, I think most people like the molecules of the month, because mm-hmm. you give a broad range of different therapeutic targets for different diseases. And it gets you outside of maybe your focused thinking of your area of research.
Yeah, no, that's what we hear quite often from our audience. Cool. Oliver, with that, you can share your screen and take it away. We're very excited for your talk, and we have about almost 200 participants today, so almost record levels of attendance. Everybody is super excited. So take it away, Oliver.
Fantastic. Well, thank you for joining this webinar. as Dennis showed, this is an actual an extension of the review article that I wrote back in probably July, August last year. And almost every week there is new data or new news coming out from the main players within this field. So I was just wondering, if you're wondering what this picture was, this is actually GLP-1 bound to the GLP-1 receptor. This is courtesy of Drug Hunter. They put this in another article. And the title of the talk, as Dennis has mentioned, is how GLP-1 receptor agonists evolve from diabetes treatments to weight loss treatments. This is a particularly hot area. I was actually interested in this about 6 or 7 years ago before all the hype started. So hopefully I'll give you a good history of the area. So the agenda today is to go through the facts about diabetes, the different drug classes that are used for treating type 2 diabetes, the role and action of GLP-1, the evolution of the receptor agonists for GLP-1, and then we're going to look beyond diabetes. Hopefully I will keep to time, so Dennis, if I'm going too long, please do let me know. So in 2021, the International Diabetes Foundation collated a lot of facts about diabetes. So over 500 million people actually are living with diabetes, and it's expected to grow to about over 780 million by 2045. About 6.7 million deaths were due to diabetes or high blood glucose. So high blood glucose can lead to various complications, which I'll come on to in the next slide. About 1 in 6 births are affected by diabetes. There's a particular type of diabetes called gestational diabetes that occurs in some pregnancies. About $1 trillion is spent in health expenditure. Back in 2021. This is about 9% of the total spending on adults, so it's a huge strain on the healthcare system. About 75% of those living with diabetes are living in low to income countries, and this could be due to a poor diet or maybe a familial history with diabetes. There are probably about another 500 million people increased risk of developing type 2 diabetes at the moment. So it's a huge disease area which needs to be treated. So what are the three main types of diabetes? So there's type 1 diabetes, when the body does not produce enough insulin. And insulin is very important for the body. Insulin tells the cells to uptake glucose from the blood and either utilize it or store it as glycogen. There's also type 2 diabetes, when the body produces insulin but cannot use it very well. And then there's a third type of main diabetes called gestational diabetes, which is a temporary condition that happens during pregnancy. And as soon as the baby is born, usually the gestational diabetes disappears. So in terms of the demographic, about 90% of diabetics are type 2. About 8% are type 1, and about 2% are gestational. So each type of diabetes can lead to blood glucose levels becoming elevated. And why is this bad? Well, there's a number of consequences associated with diabetes and high blood glucose levels. It can lead to blindness, amputation, stroke, heart attack, or kidney failure. And these are a huge burden on the healthcare system and also have a devastating effect on the patient's life. The main risk factors associated with type 2 diabetes are familial history or genetics. Also, type 2 diabetes can come on from having an unhealthy diet or physical inactivity. So like any good doctor will say, eat healthily and be physically active. And as a result, you'll avoid excessive weight gain. For type 1 diabetics, obviously checking blood glucose levels is very important, and then injecting insulin if your blood glucose levels are too high. So the main key to controlling diabetes is by controlling blood glucose levels. So if we take a look at the blood glucose how you measure blood glucose levels, you can look at it in three ways. You can either look at the blood glucose in mg per deciliter or millimolars per liter. More easily available is what we call a hemoglobin A1C score. And this is the percentage of glycated hemoglobin in the blood. That's the percentage of glucose that is associated with hemoglobin. Now, good levels of hemoglobin or normal blood sugar levels in non-diabetics are between 70 and 100 mg per deciliter. So that's between an A1C score between 4.5 and 5.5, I would say. And then after consuming a meal, your blood glucose will go up, probably to 150 mg per deciliter, which is equivalent of an A1C score of 7. As soon as you go above 7, you're starting to get into an area where potentially you either have a risk of developing type 2 diabetes or you do have type 2 diabetes. So realistically, you need drugs that will lower the A1C score by 1 to 2%, and if not higher, maybe by changing your lifestyle. So how would you control blood glucose levels? There's been a huge amount of research over the last century, and there's seven main types of type 2 diabetes drug classes. The first drug class to be discovered were the biguanides, synthylin in the 1920s, and then a further three biguanides in the 1950s. They work by multiple mechanisms, and they're not hugely well known, but the main mechanism is blocking gluconeogenesis within the liver. This leads to decreased glucose levels. There's only one remaining biguanide on the market. The other three have liver tox issues and withdrawn by the 1960s or 70s. This is called metformin. It's actually the first line treatment in type 2 diabetes. So you usually take this first off with lifestyle changes. The sulfonylureas were discovered in the 1950s to the 1990s. I've put 8 of these down here. They work by blocking the potassium channel on the beta cell, which produces insulin within the pancreas. This actually leads to an increase in insulin production. I'll come on to that in the next slide or two. This is one of the examples, glimepiride, that came to the market as Amaral in 1995. The third class are the mglitinides, and two of these have been approved in 1997 and 2000. They work by the same mechanism as the sulfonylureas. This is naglinide, just to show you the structure. And then the thiazolidine diones, three of these have been approved in the late 90s. Two of them, Aptos and Avandia, were in the top 20 selling drugs in the early 2000s and were mega blockbusters. They work by acting on the PPAR receptors that are resident in many, many different cells across the body. They have particular effects on the adipose tissue, and their outcome from that, activating the PPAR receptors, are decreasing glucose levels. This is Avandia, which, as I say, was a top 20 selling drug back in probably 2005, 2010. The fifth class of the GLP-1 agonists, I'm going to discuss this in greater detail as we go through the talk, but they work by increasing the GLP-1 pathway, which leads to increased insulin production. The sixth class are the DPP-4 inhibitors. There's actually five shown here. These are the five main DPP-4 inhibitors. They were discovered about the same time as the GLP-1 agonists. And the reason being for that is actually DPP-4 cleaves GLP-1 to make it inactive. So it works by a similar mechanism to, well, it basically enhances GLP agonism by GLP. The mode of action is, as I say, they inhibit the cleavage of GLP-1, which leads to increased insulin production. The most well-known drug here is sitagliptin. It was discovered by Merck, and it's on its own, it's marketed as Januvia. In combination with metformin, it's known as Janumet, and it was their big seller before Keytruda came along. the last class to be discovered are the sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitors. These work by increasing the renal excretion of glucose. Now, glucose is usually reabsorbed by the body, and this stops this from happening, so at least decrease glucose levels. This is Invokana, the structure of Invokana. It has a glucose unit, not surprisingly, and then these greasy groups that bind to the receptor, these aromatic groups. And this is a big seller for Janssen or J&J. Five of these drug classes act on the pancreatic beta cell. And I'm going to show you now on this slide where they work. But before I do that, you have to ask the question, how is insulin produced and released? So the pancreatic beta cell is shown here, and it's basically insulin pathway is activated by three different mechanisms. So if we look at the top right, when you take in food, incretins are produced within your gut. And incretins such as GLP-1 and GIP, GLP-1 stands for glucagon-like peptide 1, and GIP, glucose-dependent insulinotropic polypeptide, they are produced. And they act on the pancreatic beta cell to agonize these receptors to set off the cyclic AMP cascade, which causes protein phosphorylation and the formation of insulin granules. At the same time, acetylcholine has to bind to its receptor to set off the phospholipase cascade. This sets off, produces triinositol phosphate that acts on the endoplasmic reticulum to increase calcium levels within the cell. Diacylglycerol produces protein kinase C that's involved within the protein phosphorylation. The third part that is activated is glucose is taken into the cell. So depending on how much glucose that's in the blood, it gets absorbed into the beta cell or influxed into the beta cell. And this goes via the glycolysis mechanism, and then Krebs cycle to produce ATP. As ATP is increased, the level of ATP is increased, actually blocks the potassium channel. This leads to membrane depolarization, which causes a calcium influx. Now, when blood glucose levels are low, less ATP is produced, and the potassium channel is fairly open, so lots of potassium goes out. This causes hyperpolarization, which stops the calcium channel from being open, so you get less calcium. So when you have high blood glucose, you get more calcium. When you have low blood glucose, you get less calcium. Now, the calcium ions are very important in the insulin formation and release. So calcium drives the whole insulin production within beta cells and release. Now, as you can see, the different inhibitors, DPP-4 works in the top right by stopping GLP-1 from being inactivated. It also inactivates other incretins such as GIP. As you can see, the sulfonylureas act a bit like high levels of ATP and actually block the ATP channel. And the thiazolidine diones act on the PPAR gamma receptors within the endoplasmic reticulum. So as you can see, most of the treatments go after the pancreatic beta cell. So let's rewind back to the 1990s. So the main drugs at this point, the standard of care, were the glitazones, the sulfonylureas, meglitinides, and the biguanides. The real problem at this point in time, the therapies failed to achieve or maintain the glycemic targets in about 50% of the patients, diabetic patients, I should say. So as the understandings during the 90s of the different pathways increased, and I've shown you the whole picture on the last slide, the emphasis turns towards targets that increase the circulating concentration of insulin in a glucose-dependent manner. So of particular interest was glucagon-like peptide 1, GLP-1, it's shown here on the right. It is very active against its receptor. It has a PIC50 of 8.6. However, it has a very, very short half-life of 2 to 3 minutes. And this is due to the cleavage by DPP4 between the alanine and the glutamic acid at residues 2 and 3. Now, some people will call this GLP-1 7 to 6, because when it's prepared from proglucagon, there's translational modification to actually cleave off the first 6 amino acids to make it active GLP-1. Now, in 1997, it was shown that continuous infusion of this GLP-1 in diabetics patients resulted in the normalization of glucose either before or after a meal. So it was showing that GLP-1 had a big effect on diabetes and insulin production. So GLP-1 receptor agonism works by inhibition of glucagon release as well as causing the release of insulin. Now, why is glucagon important? Glucagon is the opposite of insulin and tells the body cells to produce glucose. So by downregulating glucagon, you're actually decreasing glucose production. GLP-1 is responsible for about 70% of insulin production following nutrient intake. So it's the main target that we should be going after to actually stop, to increase insulin and hopefully treat diabetes well. So having had a look at the right-hand side structure, I asked the question to the audience, how might you improve the half-life of this molecule? And how might you improve the efficacy of it, make it more potent? So whilst you're thinking about this, I'm going to show you the effects of GLP-1 on different organs. So the effect of GLP-1, it works obviously on the pancreas. That's where the insulin is produced. It also decreases glucagon production. It also increases beta cell proliferation. So more beta cells means that you can produce more insulin. It also decreases the beta cell death. Apoptosis, so you're actually allowing for these cells to survive for longer. In the liver, it triggers glucose production being reduced. And then in the muscle and adipose tissue, it increases glucose uptake and glucose storage. In the heart, it's been shown, and a number of the GLP-1 agonists recently have been shown to be cardioprotective against various CV events such as stroke. And then interestingly, GLP-1 also has an effect on the stomach. It reduces gastric emptying, which makes you feel fuller for longer. It also works on the CNS, where it increases satiety, so it sates your diet or your appetite, I should say. As a result, you feel like you need to take less food intake. However, it does cause nausea. As a result of all these effects, it also leads to a decrease in body weight. So hopefully you've thought about GLP-1 and how you might improve the half-life potentially, or how you'd improve the efficacy of this. So GLP-1 is 30 amino acid peptide. It's as I say, very potent against the GLP-1 receptor. The first marketed GLP-1 receptor agonist was actually isolated from the Gila monster in 1990. It's from the venom of the Gila monster. And it was named exenatide. And it was discovered by Amylin, who Lilly took over afterwards. And it was co-developed with AstraZeneca. It actually was marketed as Byetta in 2005 as a subcutaneous drug. As you can see, it's still very potent against the GLP-1R receptor. Now, what this molecule, it's an extended version of GLP-1. It's about 39 amino acids. And as you can see, it's got an extended chain, the tail, I should say, which actually improves the PK properties. It also, at the 2 position, has changed the alanine to a glycine, which actually stops or slows down DPP4 cleavage. As a result, the half-life goes up to 2 to 3 hours. So Novo Nordisk then they also brought out a longer longer duration acting drug called Bydureon in 2012. This was using microsphere technology, where the drug is released more slowly. So it's actually a once a week drug rather than two times a day that Byetta is. Liraglutide was discovered by Novo Nordisk. They took GLP-1, and what they did was they tethered an albumin binding moiety off the lysine position via a glutamate and had a palmitoyl C16 chain. This is able to bind to albumin, and it's about the plasma protein binding for this is about 98-99%. The albumin binding actually reduces renal clearance and also helps stop or slows down proteolytic cleavage by DPP4. As a result, the half-life is 12 to 13 hours. This was marketed as Victoza in 2009. The next company to get on board was GSK. They came up with albiglutide, and it's actually a dimer of GLP-1. And the main change is the amino acid at the two position is changed to a glycine that actually stops or slows down DPP4 cleavage. They also fused an albumin to the second GLP-1 molecule. And as a result, this albumin binding, again, has increased the half-life, and now it's 5 days. So it's pretty much a once a week drug. And this was marketed as Tanzium in 2013. Lilly took an antibody approach where they took the Fc fragment of an IgG antibody, and they attached modified GLP-1. Again, they've altered the amino acid at the two position to a glycine. And this, using an antibody approach, antibodies always have long half-life. So this half-life is 3.75 days. And this was marketed as Trulicity in 2014. And then Novo Nordisk came up with a second generation molecule where they introduced a spacer motif about 16 atoms in length, which was optimum. And then they put the glutamic acid and an albumin binding moiety. In this case, they put a fatty acid, which has better albumin binding than liraglutide. This was actually marketed as Ozempic in 2017. It has a half-life of 6.5 days, so again, a once-a-week drug. They're able to come up with an oral formulation for this drug, and they market that as Rybelsus. They use SNAC technology, which is basically a salicylic acid coupled to an amino acid, and this affects the gut pH, so prolongs the half-life of, and also allows for oral bioavailability of this drug. So I'm just going to quickly go through the strategies that have been utilized. So the first one was modified residue 2, so go from alanine to a glycine or an amino isobutyric acid. So that's also was in semaglutide. So DPP4 usually cleaves at the two position. As soon as you put in the other residues, you stop that. Adding an albumin binding motif increases stability against DPP4 proteolysis, as well as reducing renal clearance. And this is just liraglutide shown here. And then there's the Lilly approach where they use an antibody. And we know that IgG antibodies bind to protective neonatal Fc receptors. That helps them evade the metabolism by the lysozyme. So I'm just showing you the five drugs that from the last slide and showing you that they all use slightly different technologies. So how do these GLP agonists compare in terms of reducing blood glucose levels? So if we look at the glucose table again, we really want to be reducing the A1C score by probably 1 to 2 units if we can. So if we look at the head-to-head trials, these are the early trials of exenatide against liraglutide and also lixisenatide. That's a drug by Sanofi. And as you can see, at different doses, they have different effects. but they're all good drugs. They're all reducing A1C by 1 to 2 units. When you look at the next 8 head-to-head trials, we have dulaglutide, which is in green, also known as Trulicity, against the predecessor drugs, and it fares very well. And then the sustained trials and the pioneer trials of looking at semaglutide against its predecessors. The pioneer trials are looking at the oral version of semaglutide, and as you can see, they all work very well. Probably semaglutide is one of the best. So how do these drugs differ? So if we look at the evolution of the drugs, exenatide at the beginning as Byetta was given twice a day, 5 to 10 micrograms. The extended version was 2 mg once a week. So they're improving there. But as you can see, the later drugs, all of them are now once a week. And they're pretty low doses. Now, semaglutide, as its oral form, Rybelsus, is the only oral drug for diabetes, for GLP-1 receptor agonists that's oral. Some have been discontinued due to poor sales and poor uptake due to better drugs coming to the market. So as I've shown in the top right here, GLP-1 receptor agonists, they work on the GLP-1 receptor. So in addition to being effective in treating type 2 diabetes, they're also caused weight loss in type 2 diabetes trials. So why is this? I've already kind of alluded to the answer. In the red boxes, GLP-1 reduces gastric emptying, and also on the CNS, it means that you take up less food intake and you do get a reduction in body weight. So Novo Nordisk decided to test their first generation GLP-1 agonist, liraglutide, for weight management or weight loss. And they did a double blind trial of liraglutide in a trial called Scale for non-diabetic patients. They had two patient groups, placebo and liraglutide group. As you can see, the two groups, they have similar characteristics in both groups, especially in the BMI category. So it showed if these groups are similar, then you know the results are indicative going forward. So at 56 weeks, the liraglutide group, when you take 3 mg once a day of liraglutide for 56 weeks, the group lost about 8% of their body weight versus 2% for placebo. More interestingly, 63% of the liraglutide group lost greater than 5% of their body weight. And about a third of the liraglutide group lost greater than 10% of their body weight, and 14% greater than 15%. Now, up to this point, most weight loss drugs, the maximum you lose is about 5% of your body weight. So these were stellar results. So liraglutide was approved in December 2014 as Saxenda for the treatment of chronic weight management. So if we look at the revenue for Saxenda, so Saxenda is the obesity side of liraglutide sales. As you can see, over 5 years, it started to grow sales up to about 900 million by 2020. When you put it side by side against Victoza, which is the diabetes arm of liraglutide, as you can see, Victoza's revenues are much greater. So it's still mainly used for diabetes. Or the revenues suggest that. So with the advent of semaglutide, could it be better for liraglutide, better than liraglutide for obesity? So again, another double-blind trial went ahead with semaglutide called Step 1 for non-diabetic patients. It is to ascertain whether a 2.4 mg dose of semaglutide once a week, remember liraglutide was once a day, this was once a week in a 68-week trial to see if it was effective in weight loss. Now, again, the patient populations, placebo and semaglutide, were very similar to make sure that we could see the real effect. And what they found after 68 weeks, semaglutide group lost just under 15% of the body weight on average, compared to 2.4% for placebo. Interestingly, 86% of the semaglutide group lost greater than 5% of their body weight, 69% greater than 10% of their body weight. Half the people lost greater than 15% of their body weight, and a third lost greater than 20%. These are huge numbers. When you go from, say, 100 kilos to 80 kilos, that's a massive drop-off in weight. So semaglutide was approved in June 2021 as Wegovy for the treatment of chronic weight management. So when we look at it side by side against the other Novo Nordisk obesity drug Saxenda, as you can see, Wegovy, due to its supreme profile compared to liraglutide, it started to get very good sales by 2023, so just over $4.5 billion. When we look at the two drugs, semaglutide and liraglutide, in their respective diabetes or obesity areas, as Ozempic, Wegovy, Victoza, and Saxenda, as you can see, semaglutide as Ozempic, that is the third biggest selling drug in the world as of 2023. It also, Wegovy, its obesity arm, is now making about just under $5 billion a year in 2023. This may be due to a lot of patients being moved from liraglutide to semaglutide treatments instead. So where else might you act on the body to reduce the appetite and glucose levels? Now, there's not many other places you could go, but of particular interest, because the two receptors, GIP and GLP-1, are sort of a dual receptor, a lot of companies have looked into GIP. So when we look at GIP and the effects on different organs, when you look at it in the CNS, it has the same sort of effects as GLP-1, but it reduces nausea. So this could be a beneficial thing if you had a dual GLP-GIP dual agonist. In the pancreas, it actually increases glucagon production. That's not necessarily a bad thing. That could reduce fat stores in other cells. And then in the liver, it has the same effect as GLP-1, except for the lipid accumulation. In the case of adipose tissue, this is where GIP kind of comes into its own. It's very much more involved with the storage aspect within adipose tissue. In the case of muscle, it has the same effect as GLP-1. It has no effect on the heart or the stomach, but maybe having a dual GLP-1 GIP agonist, you could get the best of both worlds from their effects. So several companies have been working on designing dual GLP-1 GIP receptor agonists. So how do you go about designing a dual GLP-1 GIP receptor agonist? Well, you would look at the natural agonist. So you've got GLP-1, then you've got GIP. GIP is, I think, about 41, 42 amino acids. It's the natural substrate for the GIP receptor, and it has a PIC50 of 7.87 for its receptor. Again, it has a very short half-life. It is cleaved at the two position, the alanine, by DPP4. The other approach would be to utilize strategies from the literature or commercial compounds. So Lilly has done just that. They've designed terzpatide. It's a dual GLP-1 GIP receptor dual agonist. And it's known as terzpatide or Mounjaro for diabetes. It has a half-life of 5 days, and you might recognize some of the moieties that, within it. So if we look at those, it actually shares 15 residues from GLP-1. It shares 19 residues from GIP. It also has placed on the exenatide tail, which improves PK within these molecules. And it's utilized the albumin binding moiety technology that Novo Nordisk has used so successfully. It uses the similar spacer. The one major difference is the fatty acid is a C18 fatty acid rather than a C16 fatty acid. Now, where they get their patent space, I do not know, but maybe that is it. So why did Eli Lilly make these choices? So is it a balance of retaining agonist activity for both GLP-1 and GIP receptors, and changes to the amino acid at various positions can dial in or dial out agonism for each receptor? So if we look at the first 20 or 24 amino acids, depending on what you put in those positions, you can either increase or decrease GLP-1 or GIP activity. So I'm going to just circle or put the square box around the residues that are chosen within terzpatide. And as you can see, some work synergistically, such as position 10, where the tyrosine increases both GLP and GIP activity, or sometimes they work against each other, and it's a balance. So overall, these changes led to a potent GLP-1 GIP dual receptor agonist. As you can see, it's more potent against GLP-1 receptor than the GIP receptor. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing. GIP agonism only works when blood glucose levels are lower. So if you get GLP-1 agonism that reduces blood glucose levels to an extent, then you can kick in with GIP agonism. So what effect does terzpatide have on blood glucose levels? It lowers the A1C score by about 2%, similar to Ozempic, but you have to recognize that Ozempic is shown as 1 mg here, whereas Mounjaro is up to 15 mg dosing. So terzpatide was approved in May 2022 as Mounjaro for type 2 diabetes, and it achieved just under $500 million in sales in 7 months. So attention turned towards terzpatide in weight management trials. These trials were called Surmount. There were 4 trials, but there is actually a 5th one, and I'll tell you about it in a minute, called Surmount 1, 2, 3, and 4. So this was measuring the efficacy of terzpatide in overweight adults without type 2 diabetes and with type 2 diabetes. The Surmount 1 trial is dosing 15 mg of terzpatide once a week for 72 weeks versus placebo. And the Surmount 2 trial is the same, but within the type 2 diabetes patient population. Surmount 1 results were 22% reduction in body weight versus 3% reduction in placebo. In the diabetes group, Surmount 2, there's a 15% reduction. So it's not so effective in the diabetic population. The Surmount 3 trial was an 84-week trial with a 12-week intensive lifestyle lead-in. Within those 12 weeks, the patients had to lose 5% of their body weight before being given the drug. At the end of those 12 weeks, the remaining people that had lost 5% of their body weight then took 15 mg of terzpatide once a week for 72 weeks versus placebo. The result from this is a staggering 26% reduction in body weight versus the 3% weight gain for placebo. This is the biggest weight reduction of any drug so far in the clinic. Surmount 4 trial was 15 mg of terzpatide once a week for 36 weeks. And then either the patient stayed on terzpatide or they got placebo for a further 52 weeks. And even with the number of the patients on placebo, there was still an overall 21% reduction in body weight for the whole set of patient population. So terzpatide was approved as Zepbound in both the UK and US on November the 8th, 2023 for weight loss and weight management. When we stack up terzpatide against semaglutide and liraglutide as Mounjaro, as you can see, Mounjaro's type 2 diabetes revenues are already up above $5 billion per year. So they're gaining very rapidly on the Ozempic market share. In terms of looking at the overall picture, the worldwide revenues of diabetic and obesity drug classes from 2009 to the end of 2023, as you can see, the insulin class that treats type 1 diabetics was always the market leader until recently. And the GLP-1 receptor agonist, especially for type 2 diabetes, has seeing a meteoric rise in the last few years. Now, these figures may be skewed that doctors are actually prescribing the GLP-1 receptor agonists that I put in for type 2 as for obesity. But as you can see, the green line is the GLP-1 receptor agonist for obesity. So again, there's a big uptick, and that's probably going to exponentially increase. The SGLT2 inhibitors also seen a very steep rise. And this is because they not only do they treat type 2 diabetes, they are also treat various cardiovascular events. So where next? So Dennis quickly showed you the two articles on the small molecule GLP-1 agonist or for glipron from Chugai and Lilly. It's currently in phase 3. And also there's a drug from Pfizer, again in phase 3, which is danuglipron, a much smaller molecule. Also, Lilly are looking at a triple agonist, so GLP-1, GIP, and glucagon triple agonist, and this is called retatrutide, and it uses similar motifs that we used before for semaglutide and the various Novo Nordisk and drugs shown previously. Also, Boehringer Ingelheim and Zealand Pharma have got together, and they're currently in phase 3 for obesity for this GLP-1 glucagon dual agonist. As you'll see, there are a number, within glucagon, there's a number of residues that are GLP-1-like, and these are shown also within these drugs. Or Amgen has taken a different approach. They've gone after a bispecific called AMG-133. It's actually a GIP receptor antibody, so they're actually antagonizing GIP. And then they also got GLP-1 agonist or a peptide that will agonize GLP-1. So they're taking a slightly different approach to the rest of the field. The news that came out within the last week, there's actually been two stories. Amycretin from Novo Nordisk is in phase 1 and very impressively has shown a 13% weight loss within 3 months. And the share price went up by another 10% as a result of this news. So now it's over to you for questions. Within this word box, I haven't mentioned much about NASH or cardiovascular, but semaglutide or Wegovy has now been had its label expanded to cardiovascular events as well as weight loss. So it's opened up a huge market. And these drugs also have been looked at for NASH as well, which is a liver fatty disease. So again, these obesity drugs would be very good. So I now open it up to questions and answers.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Oliver, for this really, really cool overview. Like, that was a fantastic walkthrough of, you know, how these drugs have developed over time. And we already have a few questions here in the Q&A box. The first question is from David Miller, and he's asking, how do these things get into the CNS? That's a really good question that I'm wondering myself too.
I haven't actually looked into that, but I would say, it has to be some kind of transporter mechanism because they're peptides. They're natural peptides. So obviously the body over time has evolved to allow them to disperse through the body. They are very large molecules, but peptides are everywhere in the body. So
yeah, and they do get transported into the brain. That's right. Yeah, we have another question here from Christos. He is wondering, what are the long-term side effects, if any, of the GLP-1 agonists on different organs that they exert an effect on and on the overall physiology of humans? After so many years of continuous use, we should have obtained pretty good idea on these effects.
Again, I haven't looked into that, specifically. I do know the side effects. I don't know if that's going to help, but I haven't looked into that. I think we could maybe after this send out a message with the correct answer.
Yeah, no worries. Shema actually has a related question. She's saying there's recent evidence is suggesting that GLP-1 may contribute to muscle wasting as part of the weight loss effect. Some companies are exploring co-administration of GLP-1 agonists with muscle preserving agents such as apelin agonists. Is there any insight that you could share on that approach?
Well, I know that Shayma wrote the article, other articles for Drug Hunter, so she probably knows more than I do. But yeah, obviously, if you're having a huge weight loss, your muscles mm-hmm. will waste away as well. It's a bit like being in space. I think there will have to be multiple different approaches, sort of dual drugs, that kind of thing. So yeah.
Yeah, I actually wonder myself, like, has anybody ever tried combination therapy of DPP-4 and GLP-1 agonism, the inhibitors and the agonist co-dosed?
So, sorry, say that again, which target, sorry?
So the DPP-4 inhibitors plus a GLP-1 agonist.
Yes, I've looked into that, and there's various reports out that actually administering both does not have an additional effect at all. If anything, it's the same effect as just having GLP-1. GLP-1 is the driver, I think. Because if you look at the half-lives of these drugs now, they're up in the 7 days spectrum. So they're not actually being cleaved by DPP-4, so it has very little effect, the DPP-4 inhibitors.
Yeah, so another person here is wondering, Yogesh, what are the other, other than DPP-4, metabolic sites on semaglutide or Mounjaro?
Oh, that's a very good... very good question. I mean, peptides are cleaved by proteases, so they will be cleaved over time. Obviously, the changes they've made are to stabilize the molecules. So I think if we had any experts within the audience, they may be able to give the answer there. If there's anyone from Lilly or Novo Nordisk, mm-hmm. that would be very useful. So I don't know the exact answer to that.
All right. Yeah, we can get back to the audience later. Another question would be, is there any human genetic gain of function weight loss data for GLP-1 receptor agonists?
I haven't come across that myself. I'm an enthusiast in the area. I'm not a full expert on the area. I've never worked on diabetes or obesity. So,
No worries. Then maybe like this patent question here. So liraglutide is coming off patent this year, ? And how do you think this will shake up the market?
To be honest, an awful lot of the patients have been moved across to semaglutide treatment. So I'm trying to think of the names, Rybelsus and Ozempic. So I think Novo Nordisk have been pretty clever with their GPs and doctors to say move across to the second generation GLP-1 inhibitors. It may have an effect, but to be honest, they're doing very well at the moment, Novo Nordisk. So,
yeah,
they're the most valuable European company at present. A bit like Lilly, the most valuable pharmaceutical company at the moment in the US.
That's actually quite impressive. They have some tech valuations at the moment, right?
yes.
Yeah. Maybe an opinion question from Alexander Dümling. What is the worst drug in the slide, top weight loss drug?
The worst one. Sorry, hang on a moment. So do you mean here or do you mean in the GLP-1?
Probably this one. I think that they were he was referring to this title here, top weight loss drugs.
Well, I would say the bottom one. Do you really want to take a super absorbent stomach gel, which is hydrogel? That doesn't look very nice in my mind. I would say yes, you get very good weight loss, but the side effects are not nice.
Got it.
I don't know enough about these drugs, but looking at the side effects, obviously weight loss is associated with some nasty side effects. Even the GLP-1 mm-hmm. receptor agonists have a lot of GI symptoms, which are not nice. And if you're a diabetic, you probably have them as well. So, yeah.
Now, one of the side effects that the audience was mentioning is a hypoglycemia.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you can comment further on that? Is that worse with GLP-1 receptor agonists or with a dual combination of GLP-1 receptor agonists compared with GIP receptor agonists?
I don't know the honest answer to that, but when patients are dosed, they are incrementally dosed. So they might start off on a much lower dose. So probably when that happens, you would hope the GPs or the physicians would be monitoring for hyperglycemia. So by taking a stepwise approach, hopefully that lessens the hyperglycemia effects that might be seen, if that makes sense. It's something maybe I should look into, and we'll come back to the audience.
Yeah, no, we definitely, and maybe since we're slightly over time, maybe we'll close with the last question. From Marco, is there any worry that DPP-4 could mutate and enable to cleave the two-position modified peptide if the drug is administered over a prolonged time?
The AIB residue is non-natural, so that might be better than changing to a glycine. So a lot of the drugs have glycine, so those might fare worse. These DPP-4 and DPP-4 is a protease, so it has lots of other functions in the body. So it cleaves other incretins, so I think it has to be quite selective for the other incretins as well. And it seems to recognize alanine quite a lot. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if it mutated, would your body do some other weird stuff? So I don't
probably
know.
It probably would, right?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much, Oliver. Thanks to the audience for the questions. Yeah, Oliver, was a fantastic talk. Thank you for staying on to answer the audience's questions. We even have more questions coming in.